Welcome to 7-Under Club Interactive. One of the great things about the world today is easy access to information. The internet has created a global community where you can Google Gutenberg and read the first printed book, or check out the Mona Lisa after you like the Louvre's Facebook page. It's important to see how media has shaped the world of today so that we understand what that means for the world of tomorrow.
Remember a time when life was a little slower and popular culture was more easygoing? A lot has changed since then, and everywhere you look, there's a clear indication that we live in different times. Where is this change taking us, and how will our lives be affected?
Computers were a mystery, but thanks to digital, that mystery's been solved.
Well, please welcome to the 7-Under Club Interactive, the author of FutureCast, George Barna. George, welcome back.
Gordon, good to be with you.
You've been quoted as saying the seeds sown in the 60s have now borne fruit. What do you mean by that?
Well, if you look at what took place in the 60s and even the 70s, there was a shift in our thinking about how should we live? And a vital part of that shift was one that said that really it's social norms should determine how we live. That's what should rule. And we feel comfortable with that, of course, because we're the ones who develop those social norms. So rather than going back to biblical foundations, what we've said is, okay, we'll figure out how it should really work. And that led to a whole new sense of priorities in life, which were things like comfort, and numbers and speed and enjoyment and happiness. And it shifted everything about our lives. It shifted how we think about church, how we think about God, how we think about each other, how we define success, how we use our time. And so once that shift began, there was no getting things back on the original track. And so now it's all about entertainment and leisure and feeling good and having a voice in everything that's taking place.
If you look at the history of America, you know, particularly going back to the Great Awakening, 1735, and then the American Revolution, and then the Second Great Awakening, you can look at church as being one of the change leaders in culture and in society, and one of the places where new ideas were coming out. When you look at the past 50 years, it's almost like church has been bewildered by what's going on in the culture today, and has been really behind the times. What do you see happening to church? Are we adapting quickly enough? Can we get back to the place where we were a leader in culture?
Well, I think it's possible to get back there. It's going to take some significant changes in order for that to happen. I think the primary way of describing the difficulty that you're alluding to right now is that if you want to help determine the future, you have to anticipate it, not simply react to it. And what we have today are churches that look at what's going on in culture and saying, we should respond to that, rather than looking at the trends and the patterns and saying, this is what's coming down the pike. We need to get there first. We need to change things so that these patterns don't actually emerge. We need to provide a better alternative that people will move to. And that takes strong, effective, visionary leadership. I would suggest that perhaps we don't have enough of that in the church today, or maybe if it's there, the people in the church aren't willing to allow those visionary leaders to step outside the tight boundaries of what they think the church is supposed to be. We have a real issue in this country of people not understanding the importance and the necessity, really, of integrating your faith into every dimension of life. And that needs to start with what the church does, too. It can't be restricted to the box on Sunday morning.
You've worked with a lot of parachurch organizations. You've worked with a lot of churches. You've worked on a lot of different programs. And through all of that, you've actually come to the conclusion that the best thing for the church to do today is to go back to a very simple idea of one-on-one, that just the same as Jesus came, was incarnation, and he said, I'm going to take 12 and teach them over a three-year period. Is that where you see church going? Are we really going to go back to our roots, and instead of the mega thing?
Yeah, I'm not sure that's where we're headed. I don't particularly see that, because a lot of these kinds of discussions hinge on one's definition of success. When you look at churches today, our research shows that church leaders look at five different indicators of success: attendance, how much money they raise, how many programs they offer, how many staff members are on the payroll, and the amount of square footage that they built out on the campus. All of that's great. I'm a measurement guy. I'm glad we measure things. The problem is you got to measure the right things, because you get what you measure. And the problem with those five indicators is that Jesus didn't die for any of them. We've got to go back to try to figure out, so what did he die for? And it's all about our lives being transformed, us becoming more like him, us becoming dependent upon him, devoting our lives to serving him, knowing him, loving him, being with him. And so for us to move back to those kinds of metrics, where it's all about fruit of the Spirit rather than numbers of seats that are filled on Sunday, that's a major shift. We've got a lot of debt now. We've got a lot of expectations. We have a lot of other things in place that we're going to have to leave behind in order to become small again. Why small? It's not just about size. It's about relationships. It's about connections. It's about the ability to allow God to transform us in his way, not in the way that we choose.
Well, I know for me, my thought pattern has really changed since I turned 50. I don't know what it is about getting older, but I really start to value now what I call fruit that remains, that it's the long-term relationship. It's the long-term discipleship. It is successfully seeing people change from a worldly view to a godly view. And for me, I'm getting far more satisfaction from that than I am from numbers. And I'm actually looking at how can we use the technology available today to encourage that kind of one-on-one interaction.
You know, it's a real challenge, because the lure of the technology is that it gives us so much information so quickly. It allows us to relate to so many different people. But again, when you look at how those kinds of connections are made, they tend to be relatively quick, relatively surface or superficial. I think the challenge is to take that technology and try to figure out, how can I use this not just to be connected, but to literally change other lives, and to look at the opportunity to change one life at a time. Again, because we live in a massive society, we live in a global kind of society now, we tend to look at the big picture and say, oh boy, if I can't change everything at once, it's a failure or it's not worth doing. When the reality is, even as Jesus ministered, he didn't spend all his time with the crowds. He went one-on-one, one-on-three. He was with small groups of people intensely for prolonged periods of time. And if we can take that same model and use the internet and other technology to facilitate those kinds of deeper, ongoing, more meaningful, more honest kinds of relationships, then yeah, we can really make a big impact through technology.
Where do you see America going? You know, what kind of America are we looking at 10, 20 years from now?
Well, if the patterns that are currently in place continue, it's going to be a very different kind of culture, and I'm not sure it's one that's going to really please people who hold biblical values close to their heart. When you look at family systems and what's going on in families, you know, we see that there's an increasing acceptance of homosexual couples and families. We see that divorce is becoming the norm. More people are expecting it. They're not necessarily happy about it, but they almost expect that to happen now. They accept you having been divorced once or maybe twice in the course of your life. Why? Because, again, the key metric for people is happiness. How can I be happy? You see, you know, sexuality promoted all around us. You see cohabitation that's increased by a factor of 15. It's 15 times more likely that people will cohabit today than was the case in the 1960s. Multi-ethnic marriages, more likely by a factor of 7 since the 1960s. children growing up out of divorces and all the problems that are attendant to that, more and more common. So it's, you know, if the family is supposed to be the basic building block of our society, family is being redefined. Now it's more about experimentation, it's more about seeking pleasure, it's more about shared experiences than it is a lifetime of devotion to the good of the other person and surrendering and sacrificing for the good of the other people in your family unit. You look at churches, we see that church is being redefined as well. So it's really an era of redefinition, where what Americans are trying to do is to figure out, how can I maximize my pleasure, minimize my pain, and, you know, just hang on for the ride.
Well, that's actually a chilling forecast. Well, George's book, Future Cast, it's available in bookstores nationwide. George, always a pleasure. Thank you so much for being with us.
Yeah, pleasure.
And if you're watching, I encourage you to get this. And particularly if you're a pastor or in any kind of church leadership, start understanding the trends that have already been unleashed and what we need to do about and what's the most effective response. Well, innovation and technology is spread throughout America. However, in other parts of the world, just finding clean drinking water is a challenge. Coming up, a young Cambodian girl falls into an open well while trying to get water for her family. Her story of survival, right after this.
Too much stuff? Not enough space? Well, now you can make more space in your place with our best offer ever from Spacebag.
There must be 101 ways to make more space with Spacebag.
Like number 22, take winter clothes out of the closet and store them almost any place. Just pack your stuff, seal the airtight double zipper, and suck out the air through the super fast turbo valve and store anything flat just like that. Lucky number 7. Play hide and seek with your kids' stuffed toys, which come out to play when you're ready. And number 65, unexpected guests. Bet it's mother. Who needs a linen closet? Store the bed and bath linens in the new high-capacity cube, and it stores 4 times more than boxes or bins. And all your items are completely safe with 4 layers of protection.
To lock out icky bugs, dirt, moisture, and mildew.
Running out of closet space? Turn your empty suitcase into a closet. Look at everything I've packed into what would have been wasted space. So now you can go from this to this with Space Bag.
Call now and get one of our new high-capacity cubes, one large bag, and one medium bag. All for only $19.95. That's less than the cost of one ruined sweater. But through this exclusive TV offer, we'll double your order and send you one more of each at no extra cost. But we're not through yet. We're going to make this offer irresistible and triple it. Plus, we'll also send you our new Space Bag Organizer. It's attractive enough to store in plain sight and easy to carry. Yours free. Just pay separate shipping and handling. It's our best TV offer ever. An $80 value, yours for only $19.95. And with our money-back guarantee, it's risk-free. This special TV offer is not available in stores, so call or click now.
In a village in western Cambodia, there was only one place to get water. But it was also the most dangerous place in town.
20-year-old Kay remembers the day she fell into an open well near her home and nearly drowned. She was only 3 at the time.
It was cold and dark inside the well. I was so scared. I thought I was going to die.
Thankfully, Kay's uncle saw her fall and was able to rescue her.
Since that day, I have been afraid to go near the well. Every time I have to get water from it, my heart is filled with fear.
Then, a few years ago, one of Kay's elderly neighbors fell into the well. She eventually died from her injuries. Now that she's married, Kay doesn't let her children anywhere near the open well.
The people in our village wanted to board it up, but we can't. We have no other water source, so we have to use it.
So Operation Blessing dug a new well for the village, one that's closed in and has a pump.
I am so happy that CBN dug us a new well. We can get all the clean water we need safely.
And the villagers boarded up the old well. That's been a huge relief for Kay and her neighbors.
I am not afraid anymore, for me or the kids. Thank you, CBN, for helping us.
And thank you. If you're a member of the 700 Club, you're part of that. If you're not a member, we invite you to join with us. It's a toll-free call, 888-777-1999. Just say, I want to be a part of everything you're doing around the world. How much is it? Well, it's just $20 a month. That's only 65 cents a day. If you want to make a special gift to water, to provide drinking water in villages around the world, not just Cambodia, India, Thailand, Philippines, Indonesia, China, we're making a difference for people. We're getting them water. And if you want to make a special designated gift to water wells, all you have to do is go to CBN.com, go to the giving page, and there's a place where you can designate your gift, and 100% of that fund goes into building water wells around the world. So if you want to do that, just go to CBN.com. When we come back, a porn addict is caught by his wife. See what happens after his secret is revealed right after this.
It was a devastating car accident.
Ronnie had his seatbelt on, but it broke it. And when it threw him out the window, the car actually turned over a couple of times.
He had a very low chance of survival.
But Clarice Holden would not give up.
So I just went back to our friends and I said, guys, we are not going to be wringing our hands saying poor Ronnie.
And so the battle for her husband's life began on the 700 Club next.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior. If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free. All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free. I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
40 years ago, John Cozart saw pornography for the very first time. But that day, John didn't just open up the pages of a magazine. He opened up his world to a lifetime of addiction.
First time I looked at pornography, it was exciting, but yet I felt like I was doing something wrong, something that I was not supposed to be doing. It was difficult to put it down. It was difficult to walk away from it. The addiction began to take root.
John Cozart was a young boy when he first saw pornographic magazines at a friend's house. It wasn't long before he had his own stack of magazines and a secret addiction.
A lot of sneaking around, a lot of secrecy, a cycle of self-gratification, looking at the magazines. It continued throughout my teenage years.
He married Joy at 19 and hoped his addiction was over. It wasn't, and the internet made it easy to be discreet at home.
There was this euphoric feeling swept through me, and it like took me to another place. Some of the stuff that was popping up, it was a lot more graphic, more sexually explicit than what I was exposed to even as a teenager, than the magazines that I had looked at. I had this feeling of like, wow, here we go again. You know, this thing's followed me into my marriage. I found myself retreating to my office and spending more and more time looking at pornography on the computer, and once again, keeping it a secret from my wife.
John became a Christian in his 20s, but still felt powerless to overcome his porn addiction.
Because of the guilt, because of the shame, I began to withdraw from the Lord. And you know, looking back, there was probably even a withdrawal from my wife, even early on. And the guilt was telling me that I was doing something wrong, and the shame was telling me that I was wrong, that there was something wrong with me.
His secret was revealed when Joy walked into his office. She was shocked to see pictures of naked women on his computer screen.
It was almost like I had just put a knife into her. She had that look in her face, in her eyes, like, you've just betrayed me. You've just, how could you? After all that we've been through, the trust was gone. Everything that we had built over the years of our marriage was gone. There was nothing I could say. My words meant nothing. My apology meant nothing. I'm sorry meant nothing.
Hope finally arrived when a friend gave John a CD called Somebody's Daughter, A Journey to Freedom from Pornography.
I just wanted to be free, man. I wanted to be pure. I was a Christian, and I wanted to get back that intimacy that I had early on as a new Christian, as a new believer. So I remember the first day that I ever listened to that CD, and I felt like for the very first time that there was hope. It was like somebody was saying to me, I know where you're at. I know what you've gone through. I know what you're going through now. And they were telling me that you can get through this. And I felt like at that particular point that God was answering my prayer.
John took the first steps on his journey toward freedom from pornography.
It really started with me and just being honest and being vulnerable and saying, this is where I'm at. The thing about sexual sin is it thrives in secrecy, in darkness. That's where it lives. Once I began to verbalize my addiction, the power began to subside, and it started to diminish just almost overnight. The intimacy that I once had with God has returned. There's a passage of scripture in Psalm 51 that says, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. And being free, that joy has been restored. You know, my wife and I will be celebrating 30 years of marriage, and I'm proud of that. I really am. Man, she is the love of my life.
John runs Unshackled Ministries. He is devoted to help men find freedom from pornography addiction, just as he did.
The Bible says, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So when I read that verse, man, that tells me that God himself does not condemn me. He doesn't condone my sin, but God loves me, and there's nothing that I could do that could ever separate me from God's love. He's there willing and waiting to set us free, to give us the life that we've longed for. It starts with honesty. It starts with confession. Once you bring this sin out of the darkness and into the light, that's when freedom begins.
You can be free. Maybe you're like John. Seems to be a familiar story in our culture today, where you got curious, you opened it, you took a look, and then your body chemistry took over. And a lot of people don't understand this, but there's a triggering mechanism from the visual images that leads to euphoria. And doctors now claim that there's actually a triggering event that's quite similar to taking the drug cocaine. And so it becomes addictive, and you keep coming back to it, and you're looking for that euphoria. But what you don't understand is that it's addictive, and that it does lead, and you do understand this, it does lead to guilt and shame, and it leads to hiding. And it leads to lying. Now, the good news in all of this is you can walk free. What does it take to do that? Well, it takes what John just told you. You have to become transparent. You have to bring it into the light and say, I've got this. I've got this going on. Now, that is hard. You know, a lot of your pride is at stake. But when you do come to the light, then you understand that God hasn't left you. God hasn't abandoned you. He wants you. He wants you to be with him. And when you start understanding he died for you, he can take care of that. He can take care of the compulsion. He can make you new again. And the great thing is he never gives up. He'll make you new again and again and again. All you have to do is come back to him and ask for it. The Bible is very specific. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now, you saw it in John. You saw it in his eyes. You saw that, yeah, he is free. He's not enslaved to anything anymore. And he's celebrating 30 years of marriage. Now, if you want this, if you want to be free, I encourage you right now, all you have to do is call a toll-free number, 888-777-1999, and just say, I want to confess what I've been doing, and I want forgiveness, and I want Jesus to come into my heart and to cleanse me. Now, we're not interested in condemning you. We're not here to do that. We're here to bring the love of Jesus Christ to you, to you. So when you call, you're not going to get, you've been bad. You're going to get, how can you get free? How can you walk free? How can you have the freedom that comes with Jesus Christ in your heart? No longer turning away from him, but turning to him, and you can be free indeed. Call it. Do it right now. 888-777-1999. Got time to take some prayer calls. Here's Wendy from Illinois. Hi, Wendy. Wendy, you there?
Yes.
How can I pray for you?
Well, I have a little bit of depression, mm-hmm. and my back is real sore, and I have other health problems too, but I just want prayer to feel better, you know.
Okay. Did you wrench your back?
No, every so often it comes and goes.
Okay. And it's in the lower back?
Yes.
And is it around the left side?
Yeah.
And it goes down into your hip?
Occasionally.
Okay. In Jesus' name, Wendy, be healed. And lower back be healed now in Jesus' name. And all that pain on the left side, all of that be gone. And we just speak to her muscles, relax now. We speak to her entire spine, be in alignment. And we just set her free from this. And Lord, we set her free from the other ailments as well. And we ask for a restoration of her joy and her peace in you. And we just, I ask for her to be just showered in joy, that she would, joy would just be raining down in her life, and she would be surprised how much joy you can bring to her right now where she is. In Jesus' name, restore it to her now. Amen. And amen. Wendy, could you move your back around for me?
Well, I'm walking. It's not as bad, but...
Well, not as bad would be good.
Yeah.
were you walking before? Were you able to walk before, right?
Yeah, okay. I was always able to walk, but it's mostly when I sit down that's sore, you know.
Okay. But it's getting better.
Yeah.
I heard you laugh.
Yeah.
You haven't done that in a couple of weeks, right?
No. Huh?
Laughing would be good. Wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would be.
Okay. All you have to do is turn your thinking and start understanding Jesus wants to bless you. He's not far from you. He's with you right now.
Okay, thank you.
All right. Thank you, Wendy. That's all the time we have for this program. We leave you this word from Luke. Blessed are all who hear the word of God and put it into practice. God bless you. We'll see you again.